when Luther's preaching on the parables, he doesn't do the same kinds of things with narrative very much. Jesus already had used the story, and so he resorts pretty much just to catechesis, Luther does. And that'll become obvious as I talk a little bit more. I want to set as background Luther's redefinition of what it means to be Christian, and I have to confess that I didn't really realize what the Reformation was all about until 2008, so less than a decade ago. And it took my students in Chennai, Madras, in South India, to really inform me as to why the Reformation was the Reformation as we know it. I had explained to them, I'd used the material of a professor of comparative religion named Ninian Smart. I'm not even sure it was original with him. But people who teach comparative religions have to compare religions, and they have to have a basis for that. And so Smart developed this list of six elements that he thought all religions have. I'm not sure. Well, he didn't say that they have them in equal measure, so maybe he's right. At any rate, this is my translation of his list and my ordering. Forgotten exactly what his is. But religions have doctrine. They have narrative or story. He used the word myth, but he didn't necessarily mean non-factual myths. He meant stories that convey a truth. They have ritual, the way we relate to God, or whatever higher power there is. They have ethics, how we relate to each other. They have a sense of community, including the hierarchy that sort of governs the community, but also the community relationships. And then they have something that binds it all together. Christians have faith. Muslims have submission. Buddhists have the search for nirvana or something like that. I'd explained to them that, and we were reading Luther's Babylonian Captivity of the Church, his critique of the sacramental teaching sacerdotal teaching of the medieval church, and he kept criticizing the Latin phrases ex opere operato. What that means is that the sacraments work automatically on the popular level. All the Protestant reformers and some Roman Catholic reformers recognized that what that had done was not protect the validity of the sacraments so much as make it seem as though going through the outward motions were all that you needed. And I said, well, of course Luther criticized that, but I don't know why he harps on it page after page after page. And they said, well, that should be clear. You've just told us about these different elements. And from their Hindu culture background, they noticed that Luther had grown up in a religious culture which fundamentally still had the underlying structures, not the superficial language, but the underlying structures of the pagan religions that had been replaced when Christianity, without adequate personnel to preach and to teach, came to, in Luther's case, his native Thuringia. And so they pointed out that Luther had grown up as a child and then also as a student with a system that basically focused on the performance of the ritual and under the supervision of the hierarchy. And the deeper he got into his biblical studies, the more he realized that, that first of all, it was not the direction of the Christian faith was not from our performance to God, even though his university professors at least certainly informed him that you needed grace to do that properly. But the direction in Scripture is that God comes to us. He comes to us as a talking God, as a speaking God, and he comes to us to give us life and to open up the conversation. It's not a conversation without two sides. What Luther learned was that his initial impressions of how to be a good Christian simply were wrong. what his parents and his priest, his teachers in Mansfeld, where he grew up, had taught him, and what his university professors at the University of Erfurt instilled in him. It simply was not what Scripture says is the reality of our relationship with God. And so what that meant was that the sermon became really fundamental for the whole Christian life, for the conduct of the life of the church, but really for the life of each individual in the church as well. Now, that doesn't mean that Luther discarded ritual at all. Doesn't mean that he discarded the hierarchy at all. He had a strong view of the pastoral office. At the same time, he had a strong view of the priesthood of all the baptized. And he believed that the Lord's Supper is a means of grace, that it conveys the promise of God, and that it's a very important part of the Christian life. But in 1526, when he composed his German order of service, he said that preaching and teaching of God's word is the most important part of the divine service. And Luther, one of my friends now with the Lord, would get angry. He really would get angry sometimes if you said Luther was a monk, because he wasn't a monk. He was a friar. And the difference is that monks stayed in the monastery for the most part. Friars were out on the street hearing confession and preaching, helping local priests take care of the preaching tasks. Sometimes the local priest wasn't well-educated at all and couldn't preach, and the friars, the Augustinian friars or Dominicans or Franciscans, would come and preach for them. Estimates are that Luther probably preached 4,000 times in his life. We have only 2,300 records of sermons he preached, notes from students, sometimes edited by those students and published. Luther's known as a professor of Old Testament, but he gave lectures on, for instance, Galatians twice, on 1 Timothy. So there wasn't a strict observance of the kind of informal division of the curriculum that was observed in Wittenberg. Luther and his colleague and also his pastor, Johannes Bugenhagen, did most of the lecturing on the Old Testament, and then Philip Melanchthon and Justus Jonas and Kaspar Kreutziger took care of the New Testament, but there was a good deal of crossover. And in his preaching, Luther did concentrate largely on the New Testament. It's often said that Zwingli introduced the expository preaching on a book. Sunday for Sunday, you worked your way through a book, and Lutherans didn't do that. They preached on the so-called pericopes, the lessons appointed, and Luther insisted on that because he thought that those appointed lessons gave you an overview of the whole, we would say today, I suppose, meta-narrative. He didn't use language like that, but the whole story of our creation and fall and redemption and sanctification. So on Sundays, when Luther substituted for his pastor, Johannes Bugenhagen, who often left town because he had to organize churches all over northern Germany and even in Denmark. So when Luther was in the pulpit for Bugenhagen, he did preach on the appointed lessons that were inherited from the Middle Ages. But on the weekdays, the church ordinances for Wittenberg appointed specific books. So you preach through Matthew, you preach through John. We don't have a whole commentary on Matthew or John from Luther because Bugenhagen preached on those books when he was in town. But we have a good many sermons from both of them. And so we have a number then of sermons that actually deal with the parables. And so when the faculty here invited me, I thought it would be interesting to take a look at just what Luther did with one specific genre. Now, I suspect you may have noticed that in your professors, too. My students certainly notice it in me. A lecture can sometimes sound very much like a sermon, and a sermon often sounds like a lecture. And Luther was the same way. He did practically the same thing, sometimes with a little more emphasis in one direction or the other. But his exegetical lectures also aimed at showing the students how to preach, in the words of our Lord in Luke 24, how to preach repentance and the forgiveness of sins. And while he recognized that law and gospel have much broader meanings and multiple meanings in Scripture, repentance, the call to turn away from sin, he labeled law because it talks about what we have done or what we have not done in the case of calling us to repentance. And the gospel then brings the deliverance of Christ. And so that was a kind of guiding principle of interpretation for sermons and for lectures. But what he actually did then with the biblical text was four or fivefold. First of all, he tried to make sure that because he believed God is a God of history and has woven history into our very beings, he wanted people to know what the text meant in its original context. And he looked at non-biblical sources insofar as they were available to get a glimpse of the history or the grammar and syntax of the text so that there's a kind of basic explanation of what the text means, just what the words on the page mean. The bulk of his sermons, I would say, were catechesis, that is, were instruction in what God requires of us, what that means for us as sinners, and what that means for us as a guide to Christian living, and then what God has done for us, especially in Christ, but as I said yesterday, also what God does as our providential creator for us. So the bulk really is of his preaching and certainly his teaching is in this catechetical explanation. Here's what it means for your daily life. Occasionally, Luther used allegory, as I suppose all Christian preachers have to confess they do on occasion. I doubt that any of us who have preached on Jesus calming the storm said, well, Jesus is the Lord of the weather. We've all said he calms the storms of our lives. And Luther did that sort of thing, although he did abandon allegory and the fourfold shape of the text. He rejected that quite decisively as his basic framework for interpretation and went to this distinction of law and gospel as the way to work your way through texts. And then Luther used a fair amount of typology. He found in the Old Testament texts both the foreshadowing of what Christ did for us and what the church's life would be. So there are all sorts of weaving together of the Old Testament foreshadowings and promises into the New Testament stories. But then, and this is what this book is all about. He massaged the narratives. We all have done that, I think, too, from the pulpit. It's what the writer to the Hebrews did in chapter 11, verses 17. Moses doesn't tell us what Abraham thought as he went up the mountain, but the writer to the Hebrews tells us that he was confident in the promise of the resurrection of the dead. He filled in what linguists or literary theorists call the gaps in the Old Testament stories. Well, Luther was fairly disciplined, somewhat disciplined. Well, he often exercised some discipline, let's say, in his imaginations. But he really made texts come alive, especially the narrative texts, by filling in the gaps. And so the new parents in the Wittenberg congregation got to enjoy the thoughts of Mary and Joseph as they fussed over this new first baby and what to do with him in the cold and the barrenness of the stable, or when Abraham and Sarah were sharing their distress about their childless state. The childless couples in Wittenberg got consolation from Luther's filling in, taking the liberty, we might say, to fill in a few details. And in that way, the biblical text sort of was driven into the lives and the consciousness of people. I guess it's this way in the United States. I know in Germany, many people live from what they read in what we would call the yellow journalism, the popular, the People magazine kind of thing. They live from the stories of what the royal families are doing nowadays, or what sports stars and whatnot are doing nowadays. Well, for people in the 16th century, it's pretty clear to me, both from Luther and from his students, the way they preached. Those sort of models, those sort of really interesting stories didn't come from People magazine. They came from the Bible. And although David wasn't exactly the chariot maker next door, David was a model of struggles with his own sinfulness, of challenges in carrying out his calling as ruler. And so Luther helped people understand that as he took the stories from Scripture and placed them in the context of people's lives. Luther was very sensitive to genre, to the literary form. When he was writing in 1531 and 32 on a kind of guide, brief guide to the Psalms, he would point out, for instance, that this was a psalm of comfort, that was a psalm that prophesied of Christ, another was a psalm of thanks, another was a psalm of prayer, another was a doctrinal psalm. And so Luther was conscious that different literary forms do make a difference in the way you read the text and in the way you absorb it. And so treating John 16:25, the Lord said, I have spoken unto you in parables. And Luther tried to help the people in his congregation understand what a parable actually is. And in part, he wrestles with a problem that we don't have in English. The German word for parable is Gleichnis, and it really means comparison. And so it captures the nature of a parable as a comparison or analogy. But it doesn't have any hint at all about the mysterious and hidden nature of this form of communication. And so Luther explained, quote, John calls these dark and hidden sayings parables, although the German language doesn't designate them as comparisons, but calls them enigmas or veiled sayings. In other words, we have a different word for parables. But in parables, what you have to pay attention to, Luther says, is that the meaning is to be conveyed in a way that not everyone understands. So Jesus had promised that the Holy Spirit would later explicate the dark sayings, the mysteries, the enigmas for them. And Luther goes into more detail when he is preaching on the parable of the workers in the vineyard. There he poses the question, what is a mystery? A mystery is a hidden secret that's not known. And then he goes on, this is a longer quote, the mysteries of the kingdom of God are the things that constitute the kingdom of God. For instance, Christ with all his grace, which he manifests to us as Paul describes him. For he who knows Christ aright understands what God's kingdom is and what is in it. And it is called a mystery because it is a spiritual secret, and it remains so where the Spirit does not reveal it. But Mark says in chapter 4, verse 33, Christ spoke therefore to the people with parables that they might understand, each according to his ability. Now, how does that agree with Matthew 13 and 14? He spoke to them in parables because they don't understand. Luther's explanation is, it must surely be that Mark wishes to say that parables serve to the end, that they may get a hold of coarse, rough people, although they do not indeed understand them, yet later they may be taught and then they know. For parables are naturally pleasing to the common people, and they easily remember them. since they are taken from common everyday affairs in the midst of which people live. But Matthew means to say that these parables are of a nature that no one can understand them however often they may try to get a hold of them and listen to them, unless the Spirit makes them known and reveals them. Christ took these words from Isaiah 6, where the high meaning of the divine foreknowledge is referred to, that God conceals and reveals to whom he will and whom he had in mind from eternity. Luther used the parable of the dishonest manager to give his hearers a lesson in the thorny problem of interpreting analogies and parables. Luther did not praise the manager, the dishonest manager, for squandering his master's possessions and then shrewdly appropriating his property. That was not the point of the comparison. Instead, using the second Adam imagery of Romans 5:14, Luther explains that Paul compares Christ to Adam in regard to the origin and source, but not in regard to the fruit and impact. So Adam is the source and chief of human beings as sinners. Christ is the origin and head of human beings as saints. It is in this regard that believers should act shrewdly, but not sinfully. They should use their shrewdness to do good works, not evil works. As I said, Luther did continue to use an occasional allegory throughout his life. But in connection with the parables, he rejected much of the medieval interpretation of parables that depended on allegorization. So when he's talking about those invited to the banquet in Luke 14, he informed his readers at the beginning that this banquet has nothing to do with the Lord's Supper, as medieval exegetes had claimed. This text simply teaches, quote, "While the gospel is preached and published in all the world, few people accept it. Here it is called a supper evening meal because the gospel shall be the last word or teaching that will usher in the end of the world. This supper is nothing else than a rich, expensive meal which God provided in Christ through the gospel. It's not intended to foreshadow the Lord's Supper." In this connection, Luther also contended that the preacher or reader should not try to elaborate every detail of a parable, but should identify the purpose or goal which Jesus had in telling the story and repeat his point. That's related to his caution, I think, in using allegory. When he preached on the parable of the workers in the vineyard, he countered an interpretation which his hearers might well have heard on the basis of medieval commentaries. He described the exposition of the parable found in some ancient church fathers that assigned ages of history to the different hours of the day mentioned in the parable. And often these then explained the shilling as the reward of eternal life, the reward for labor in the vineyard. Luther said, "We will let such fables pass and abide by the simple teaching and meaning of Christ, who wishes to show by this parable what the state of things are in the kingdom of heaven or in Christendom on earth. And the point of the parable is, God directs and works wonderfully by making the first last and the last first. All is spoken to humble those who are great, that they trust in nothing but the goodness and mercy of God. And on the other hand, that those who are nothing should not despair, but trust in the goodness of God. Therefore, we must not consider this parable in every detail, but confine ourselves to the leading thought which Christ intends to teach by it. We should not consider what the penny or shilling means, what the first or last hour signifies, but what the householder has in mind and aims to teach." Luther's literary sensitivity also caused him to take context very seriously when interpreting the parables. So when Jesus told the story of those who refused the invitation to the banquet at the house of the Pharisee, when he healed a person afflicted with dropsy, it is clear that in that context, the story was aimed particularly at calling the outwardly pious to repentance and to humility before the Lord. Probably the most important point for Luther is that the interpretation of every parable depends on recognizing the person who is telling the story as its chief point. Not only its chief point, but its chief interpreter. The medium is the message in Jesus' case. According to Luther, the invitation to the banquet in Luke 14, "Come, for all things are now ready," referred to the fact that Christ has been crucified, has destroyed sin and death by his death, has risen from the dead, and the Holy Spirit has been given to summarize all these things pertaining to the supper. They were all now ready, and it cost the guests nothing. In another sermon on this text, Luther observed that the supper was ready when Christ was born, suffered, rose from the dead, and John the Baptist and the apostles had gone out to proclaim that the Messiah had come. Those invited not only despised the gospel and the person of Christ at its center, but they claimed to be doing right and acting in a holy, pious manner. So this parable reflects the reality in Wittenberg. Luther says, we sin just like the Jews of Jesus' time in this regard. So for Luther, Christ is the Lord of the parables. His interpretation determines their meaning. In the parable of the sower of the seed, which we have just heard this morning, Luther noted that Christ had identified the sower as the Son of Man and the field as the hearers of the word. But immediately thereafter, in the parable of the enemy who sowed weeds in the field, Matthew 13, 24 to 30, Jesus interprets the basic elements of these two similar parables quite differently. Luther commented, who could have discovered such an interpretation, seeing that in this parable, in the second parable, he calls people the seed and the world the field, although in the preceding parable, he defines the seed to be the word of God and the field is the people or the hearts of the people. If Christ himself had not interpreted this parable, everyone would have imitated his explanation of the preceding parable and considered the seed to be the word of God. And thus the Savior's object and understanding would have been lost. The Savior's purpose, really, and understanding would have been lost. Imitating or guessing is not to be allowed in the explanation of the Scriptures. And Luther said it's kind of like Joseph's interpretation of the two dreams of the cupbearer and the baker in Genesis 40. So Luther said about the two parables, the danger wouldn't have been all that great if the seed had been interpreted to be the word of God in the second parable. But nonetheless, the parable wouldn't have been understood correctly. Luther's proclamation of the parables did include exposition of specific linguistic or historical details that helped his hearers grasp the story more fully. And his sensitivity to the way in which the people of Wittenberg might read or hear the text led him, in the case of the parable of Lazarus and the rich man, to answer four questions that he thought the people might be asking. And in a sense, he was always teaching, he was always catechizing, as well as proclaiming the gospel directly for you to the people. So he wanted to get them ever more deeply into a personal understanding of the text. So he said, there are four questions you might ask. Some people would ask, well, what's the bosom or the lap of Abraham? Can't be a natural lap. Luther used the metaphor to his theological and consolatory advantage. Quote, the human spirit or soul has no rest or place where it may abide except the word of God. And so the phrase refers to taking refuge in the promises of God. Quote, in the same way, when we face death, we must grasp and trust the word of Christ with a strong faith. The preacher referred to Christ's promise in John 11, 26. He was always cross-referencing. When Luther was when Luther was a friar in the Augustinian monastery in Erfurt, he was known as a biblicus. That was the name of, we would probably say, a living concordance. He had very early on a remarkable command of Scripture and could quote from all over and often quote relevant passages, I might say, just like I often quote relevant passages. But he had that reputation, and you see that, although I must say that in my reading of a lot of his students as well, these people didn't have football to watch on television, that's true. But they had a remarkable ability to search the scriptures and bring the relevant passages together. And to a certain extent, they did that because that was in their medieval background. They had these little collections of verses. But the recasting of the very foundations of public teaching in the Reformation meant that the old lists of Bible verses didn't always work. So I have just a tremendous admiration for the ability of these people to, first of all, to have read the scriptures apparently many times, and then to know just exactly which passages will fit their congregations as they preach. So at any rate, Luther goes on then to ask the question, how did Abraham and the rich man talk to each other? They're lying in their graves. They were experiencing torment or blessing in their consciences, which for Luther meant the conscience was a broader word than we conceive of a conscience to be. It was really your entire orientation or disposition toward life, their heart, their worldview. So despair was gripping the rich man, because when the conscience feels that God's word has been withdrawn forever from him, the thoughts of the conscience rage, and it wants the living to know what the agonies of death are, and he craves for someone to tell them. In a sense, Luther didn't really answer the question, where are they? He didn't have a geography of the afterlife, but he had a description of what people were thinking, either in their torment or in their blessing. But when did that take place? Somebody's going to ask, Luther was sure. Time is not to be measured after death, citing Psalm 90, verse 4. And he redirected his hearers' attention to the example of the rich man's agony as a warning and call for repentance. In a sense, he said, I know you have this question, but I have a more important one to answer. My students accuse me of doing that all the time. The fourth question is, I think, very interesting. This is a sermon from the early 1520s, and his fourth question shows that Luther was still working his way out of the whole medieval framework in which he had grown up. So the fourth question is, should we pray for the dead? And Luther's still wrestling with the deeply ingrained practices with which he'd grown up, and his answer shows, I think, how much reverence for the dead most of us have. So he just wasn't sure, he said. At best, when a person dies, say a quick prayer that in death that person be commended to God. But he decisively rejected masses, vigils, and prayers that are repeated year in and year out. And in addition, he makes a very interesting comment. If you had an apparition or a ghost who pretends to be that departed person or pretends to say you should go and help that departed person by paying for masses said in his or her behalf, then, quote, you should be completely convinced that this is the work of Satan. A young Reformation scholar has just published on this question of the appearance of apparitions or ghosts. And apparently that was a fairly common phenomenon experience, that people would imagine that either a dead ancestor or an agent of the dead ancestor would appear to them and demand that masses be said for their soul. And so Luther, in many places, but also in this place, decisively combats that. Well, for the most part, Luther's interpretation of parables was catechetical. He continually emphasizes that God is active in his word. It's his instrument of power to deliver forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. And so the supper to which many were invited, is, quote, the preaching of Christ, the great and glorious supper with which he feeds his guests and sanctifies them through his holy baptism and comforts and strengthens them through the sacrament of his body and blood, that nothing be lacking and that a great plenty be at hand and all become satisfied. So the word provides and everlasting food and drink. Sometimes he could catechize directly out of the parable. Sometimes he made an association and strayed from the text somewhat. But the parable of the workers in the vineyard, with its equal pay for those who had worked shorter or longer hours, led him also to remind his hearers not only of God's grace, but that all believers will encounter temptation, that even those who have worked the whole day might get a little lazy at some point and not really work the whole day. And so it's this struggle with Satan's temptations that's going on in the Christian life that Luther uses such a parable to warn against. When he talks about Luke 8 and the parable of the seed, he talks again about how the devil works in combating the attempt of the Holy Spirit to plant the word in our hearts. And so he talks about, just takes the text and runs with it, how the pleasures and cares of this life distract us, what it means to lay hold of and keep the word. But at the end, Luther is always insisting with Isaiah in chapter 55 that the word will not return without doing its thing. Throughout Scripture, Luther was sensitive to the text, what the text was saying, both about the proclamation of God's saving actions and his descriptions of the fruits of faith. Luke 24, again, preaching repentance and forgiveness of sins. And in each parable, Luther strove to find some application of this call to repentance and gift of forgiveness and empowerment to live the Christian life. So the messengers who went forth with the invitation in Luke 14 were to constrain the people to come by preaching the law, by revealing their sin, so that the hearers would recognize their sinfulness, Luther asserted in 1523. For, quote, God quickly receives a despairing conscience and a bashful and terrified heart, in which every refuge and help are taken away, and everywhere he is unable to find any comfort. So Luther wanted the members of the congregation to experience this so that they could experience the comfort of the gospel. The sermon went on, a later sermon on this text went on to say that those who are, quote, already secure and think there is no danger will experience the Lord saying, they shall not taste of my supper. We, however, who accept it with terrified hearts on account of our sins, do not reject God's grace as it is made known to us in the gospel through Christ and offered to us. We shall receive grace instead of wrath, instead of sin, eternal righteousness, instead of eternal death, eternal life. And so, as I've already said, the parable of the sowing of the seed is a perfect source for doing that sort of thing and making the contrast between those who feel they are secure and those who are terrified by their own sinfulness. Luther recognized that the people that he was running into on the streets of Wittenberg were of various kinds, and some of them needed to hear about the crass cheating in the marketplace, or breaking of the marriage vows, or gossiping and lying about their neighbors. But he also wanted to address the pious and upright who were always being tempted to depend on their own sins. And so he often talked about the guests who were invited to the banquet as an example of what I want to say. Those who excused themselves were not doing so to run off to Las Vegas. He doesn't say that. But he says they were not engaged in public course sins, in unrighteous activities. Their activities were legitimate. They were blessed by God. They were busy in the world, an implicit critique, I think, of the monastic way of life. So they were upright citizens, But, quote, we must be willing to leave body and riches, wife and child, friend and foe, if the gospel requires it. Luther's theology of the cross emerges again in his comments on the word of offense that challenges the wisdom and power of the world. And he says, he loses nothing who forsakes anything for the gospel and clings to it in true faith, which honors God and loves him above all else he has made. I talked yesterday about this threefold structure of society, and so Luther talked about the activities which go on in those, and those are godly activities. It's just that, as we see in this parable, they dare not become the end-all of our lives. They are, as Bonhoeffer would say, penultimate. Some of them are pen, that is almost ultimate. They get very important, such as our family obligations. But finally, the ultimate in our lives is God. In connection with this, trying to work with the people whose sins are at least not visible when you go through the rest of the commandments, but who become visible when you shine the light of the first commandment, fearing, loving, and trusting in God above all things. People like us, as a matter of fact. Luther uses personification in connection with a couple of the parables, at least, to talk about the sins of the pious. So when he's preaching on the parable of the rich man and Lazarus in Luke 16, Luther fleshed out the person of the rich man, whom he made into an example of the outwardly pious individual, but one who does not, Luther's explanation of the first commandment in his small catechism, who does not fear, love, and trust in God above all things. So Luther introduced the text and the man. Quote, now in this gospel text, the Lord presents to us at the same time an example of faith and of unbelief, or the state of the godless, in order that we may abhor the contrary and oppose and the opposite of love and faith, so that we may cleave to faith and love more diligently. The rich man appears in sheep's clothing as an honorable, respectable man in his life. He was just like the Pharisee who fasted twice a week and not like other people. He must have led an outward exemplary life, Luther says. But Jesus' telling of the parable gives the lesson penetrating eyes and sees deep into the secret recesses of the soul and judges the rich man according to the fruits of faith. The preacher made it clear that, quote, this man is not being punished because he indulged in sumptuous fare and fine clothes. Many faithful believers, Solomon, Esther, David, Daniel, had done that. However, quote, his heart was attached to the sumptuous fare and fine clothes. He sought them, he trusted in them. He chose them because he found all his delight and joy and pleasure in them. He made them his idols. And he gratified his own lust and lived to himself and served only himself. He was the type who would have tried to find 100 old people to help across the street. The rich man thus embodied the opposite of what faith effects in believers. Where faith is, there is no anxiety about fine clothing and sumptuous feasting. There is no longing for riches or honor or pleasure or influence and all that is not God himself. There is a seeking and striving for and cleaving to nothing except to God, the highest good alone. And so the nature of faith is, Luther says, expecting all good from God and relying only on God. That's a phrase that a little bit later he would work into his large catechism. In contrast, unbelief doesn't expect good from God. So it doesn't care for, it doesn't seek God. The hardened and unmerciful heart then, quote, has no desire to do a kindness to another human being. The rich man's dependence on material blessing led him to the next sin. From the first commandment, it goes on to sins against his neighbor. He simply would not exercise the love that the neighbor needed. If he hadn't wanted to help Lazarus himself, Luther says, he had servants. They could have gone to help Lazarus. But his own focus was on his trust in riches, and that separated him from God, and therefore he could not even produce the good works that truly loved the neighbor. Luther brought Lazarus to life as the personification of those who are not saved because of their sores and poverty and worry. There are many people who suffer from affliction and want, and yet they gain nothing by it. Poverty and suffering make no one acceptable to God, and that's probably an implicit critique of his monastic way of life as well. But for the person who is already acceptable to God, his poverty and suffering are precious in God's eyes. And Luther quotes Psalm 116, verse 15. Such a person was Luther's vision of Lazarus. Quote, his heart must have confessed that even in the midst of such poverty and misery, he expected all good things from God and was at peace in relying on him. He was richly satisfied with God's blessing and grace. This is a true and living faith, which softened his heart by the knowledge of divine goodness. So Lazarus served spiritually, even if he could do little in terms of temporal service. Even now, long after his death, he serves the whole world with his sores, hunger, and misery. His bodily hunger feeds our spiritual hunger. In this way, he teaches and comforts us by his example, showing how God is pleased with us, not when we are prosperous in the world's term, but when we believe. From Lazarus, believers should learn, quote, to trust in God, surrender ourselves to him in work, to work in us and for us according to his own good pleasure, and then be ready to serve all people. The tax collector and the Pharisee in the temple, praying in the temple, afforded another contrast between the externally pious and the repenting sinner. The tax collector, as Luther read his thoughts, had heard a word from God that touched his heart and so believed it and thus became pious, as Paul describes how piety comes to be in Romans 10:17. God must first let his work sound in our hearts, by which we learn to know and believe in him, and as a result, we do good works. Apart from his having heard God's word, the tax collector could not have displayed this repentant spirit with which he could make God great and the one thing that God wishes. This faith, which casts itself on God alone, is that which saves. This faith, Luther explained, is a living and essential thing which makes a person a new creature, changes his spirit, wholly and completely turns his life around. It goes to the foundation and accomplishes a renewal of the whole person. And that, Luther presumed, was what had happened to the tax collector in the parable. Actually, his student, Johannes Matthesius, preached on this text, and he elaborated a little bit more than Luther. He knew exactly where the tax collector had been called to repentance. The tax collector had gone out to the Jordan and heard John the Baptist preach. Now, the people in Joachimsthal, where Matthesius preached, were smart enough to know that this was a parable and John the Baptist was historical fact. Didn't bother them at all. It fit together. Of course, someone like a real person like John the Baptist would have had to, in the parable, call the tax collector to repentance. So at any rate, Luther concludes in this case, it's not so much a matter of public gross sins, murder, adultery. It's unbelief, which is in the heart, which we cannot see. This is the real sin. And here he adds explicitly, this is the real sin in which monks and priests strut forth. The Pharisee had a poisonous, wicked heart, as praising himself because of his pretended good works. And Luther preached again somewhat later on this parable and talked about the shameful and horrible idolatry, the presumption, defiance, depending on his own holiness. As there is here no fear of God, neither trust nor love, and he seeks only his own honor, we must conclude that he does not honestly and from the heart observe any of the other commandments either. Anticipating both his definition of sin in the small called articles and of trust in God in the large catechism, Luther explained, in the first commandment, especially and in the highest terms, presumption is forbidden. It is forbidden that a person should trust in himself for his own gifts or take pleasure in himself, as this works righteous person does, who struts forth and is delighted with his gifts that he has received from God, and he makes an idol of them and worships himself as though he were an excellent holy man whom alone God is bound to respect and honor. Luther compared the Pharisee to a physician who claims to be an honorable and good man, who when he visits a person sick unto death, instead of giving good advice and helping to restore him to health, does nothing but laugh and make fun of the wretched man. Such a physician would be a great villain, but so is the pious person who, as in the parable, mocks the sinner. Luther concludes, what a monstrous devil is such a beautiful saint, who can cover himself with a thin appearance of a few works, which if he performs before the eyes of the people, and what he does in his worship and thanks and praise, whereby he blasphemes and dishonors the high majesty with outrage and defiance in the open public. So Luther was imagining this scene as just happening before the people in the pews. Luther used this text to criticize, quote, especially the great and powerful noblemen and learned sophists, but also the common citizen and the farmer, who like the idea that God accepts sinners, but who refuse to accept the rebuke of God's word. Hence, it is indeed a skill, above all human skills, the most wonderful thing on earth, that a person may have the grace truly to know himself as a sinner, and yet turn around and cast away all thoughts of God's wrath, and hold to grace alone. Although Luther is reputed to have emphasized the gospel and the forgiveness of sins above all else, he also used the pulpit to cultivate Christian living. Key to the use of parables in this case is the identification of the figures in the parables with God or with some other human being or group or the hearers themselves. In a kind of surprise move, for me at least, Luther associates the shepherd in the parable of the lost sheep with the believer who knows that Christians are called to serve the neighbor in all things as the shepherd cares for the sheep. If he is poor, we are to serve him with our goods. If he is in disgrace, we are to cover him with our mantle of honor. If he is a sinner, we are to adorn him with our righteousness and piety, as Christ did for us, according to Philippians 2, verse 4. As great as external works of love are, the greatest work, however, is to render help and service through one's righteousness, through the work of faith. I must love the sinner and be his friend. I must be hostile to his vices and earnestly rebuke them. Yet I must love him with all my heart as to cover his sins with my unrighteousness. Instructions for that process of rebuking and calling to repentance the Lord gave in Matthew 18, verses 15 to 18. And Luther cites that and says, in this way, I am such an enemy of my neighbor that I cannot let him suffer. And so I have to call him to repentance. Through prayer and admonition, believers reach out to those who are living without trust in Christ to bring them into the company of God. In this same sermon, however, Luther also equates Christ with the shepherd and the woman in the adjoining parable. For Christ has lit the lamp, that is the gospel, and he goes about in the desert, that is the world. He sweeps the house and seeks the lost sheep and the lost piece of silver when he comes with his word and proclaims to us first our sins and then his grace and mercy. Christ's declaration that he is the shepherd and has laid our sins upon his back or shoulders makes us trust in him fully and makes tax collectors and other sinners run after him. And so Christ is both, as the medieval theologians said, and Luther used this language, sacrament, that is gift and example. He is our Savior, and he is the model for our lives. And all this happens continually, Luther is aware, on the battlefield between God and Satan. It's an eschatological battle. That is, it is the battle of the last times that began already in Eden and has God in conflict, God's truth in conflict with Satan and with Satan's lie. And so at the beginning of his sermon on those invited to the banquet, Luther used popular imagery, as he often did, to talk about the battle against Satan. Those who are involved in that battle dare not waver or sway to and fro. They must be convinced of their cause and be armed with clear and certain written documents, in other words, the scriptures, For if the devil gets him on his fork, or gets them on his fork through unsettled notions, he will toss them here and there as the wind does a dry leaf. And so the parable of the sower, again, as I've said a number of times, talks about how the devil comes through false teachers, through lies, sometimes through outright persecution, but more often through the subtle and often seemingly pious way of twisting the word of God and sowing the tares among the wheat. And yet, as Luther interpreted that parable, we are not to uproot or destroy the tares. We should let them grow together. We have here to let the word of God do its work, and only the word of God. The sword of the Spirit, not the temporal sword, alone can conquer false teaching. So, Luther employed his storytelling techniques to fashion his own parables on occasion when he would expand a biblical analogy or metaphor. I quoted from one example already last evening, but I'll expand on what I said about how Luther, I think, really turns the analogy of Jesus as vine and we as branches into a kind of parable. He sketched dialogues often to drive home a point, and so he compares in the comparison between Jesus as vine and us as branches. He addresses the suffering that his readers and hearers faced in daily life and would continue to face from opponents of the faith. Against the background of his theology of the cross, Luther explained that the pruning effects of suffering in the believer's life are truly beneficial. He never tried to make suffering a good thing in itself, but he presented its benefits in spite of its not being the way God planned things for us in Eden. So Luther knew that they might well address the vineyard keeper who was pruning them. His hearers might well say to Jesus, "What are you doing? Now I've got to wither and decay, for you are removing the soil from my roots and are belaboring my branches with these iron teeth. You're tearing and pinching me everywhere, and I will have to stand on the ground bare and seared. You're treating me more cruelly than anyone treats any tree or plant." And the vineyard keeper explains, "You're foolish and don't understand. For even if I do cut a branch from you, it is a totally useless branch. It takes away your strength and your sap. Then the other branches, which should bear fruit, must suffer. Therefore, take it away. This is for your own good." And so the branch and the vine continue the debate on the benefits of this suffering, and the person of the vineyard keeper moves to God the Father, who elucidates his way of operating in defeating evil. And finally, as I quoted last night, indeed Christ himself had suffered the manure of suffering being heaped upon him as God's alien work when the activities of judgment upon evil would be a part of the way in which he saved his people. And so, Luther says, we too will continue to have the manure heaped upon us as a way of cultivating the blooming of the Christian life. Luther continued by expanding the parable to attack false brethren who try to deceive us and the like. Well, to summarize then, Luther's proclamation based on the stories that Jesus told follows in general the pattern of his preaching, focusing the lessons on Jesus and on what he was trying to do with the divisive story. He retold the parables, interpreted them to fulfill his goals of preaching repentance and forgiveness of sins in each parable. He wanted to use the parables to focus on the teller of the parable and what it says about his kingdom. And so the focus is continually on the Lord who died and rose to win forgiveness of sins for his hearers and readers. Luther employed his own device of creative expansion of the text less with these narratives. He simply went with the stories. Jesus had supplied stories that were good enough in himself and that would speak directly to the lives of the people. And so the figures in the stories were put to use as, for instance, as personifications of God, or of the ungodly, or the faithful. And the narrative plot served the Wittenberg professor as a basis for preaching about the sinfulness of his hearers and also their need for forgiveness and the gift of life and salvation that faith in Jesus Christ brings. And so in each case, Luther intended that the parable would be a part of the conversation that the Lord had launched with them and was continued with them until their dying day. And it is true then for us too that these parables come to us as a particularly precious gift, I think, because they bring the word of the Lord to us in a form that that speaks to our own experience and cuts to the heart both of our sinfulness and of the wonderful gift that we have in our Lord Jesus Christ, the teller of the story. The story itself, now that I think about it. Thank you.